Hello. Godot Tutorials is not sponsored by or affiliated with Godot Game Engine. Let's go over what a finite state machine is. A finite state machine is a mathematical abstraction where an abstract machine can be in exactly one of a finite number of states at any given time. In programming, we can add state machines onto objects and change its state based on inputs. A quick example, so in this case we have two states, an awake state and an asleep state. In this case, we are awake because our isTired function returns back false. However, what happens if isTired becomes true? Well, we change from the awake state into the asleep state. In this case, we have another function called isRested, and as long as isRested is equivalent to false, we will be in the asleep state. However, once our isRested function returns back true, we will then switch to the awake state. And so in this case, you can see our finite state machine can change between two states, the awake state and the asleep state. In game programming, it is very common that game objects have multiple states for different categories. Just keep in mind that they must be independent of each other. For example, we have a character state machine for player movement, and in this case, we start in the idle state. However, at some point, our idle state can change into the run state, and our run state can change into the jump state. And at some point, our jump state needs to turn into the falling state because what goes up must come down. And lastly, as we are done falling, we change back into the idle state. Now, this looks like a basic state machine for movement. However, we can add onto this. For example, our idle state can change immediately into the jump state. And vice versa, our jump state can turn into the idle state. For example, if we jump onto a ledge, we will not fall. In addition, if we are running, we can also stop running and return back into the idle state. Now, let's look at another example where we have additional states that are independent of our character movement state. In this case, we have a character state for health. And we have two choices, being awake or asleep. We start in the awake state, and at some point, we can in fact turn into the asleep state. And vice versa, from the asleep state, we can transform ourselves into the awake state. Now, keep in mind that even though our character has two different states it manages, the health state and the movement state, the health state is independent of the character movement state. This means that health does not directly affect the states of movement, and vice versa, the states of our character movement does not change or directly affect the states of our character's health state machine. Let's go ahead and write some code. So first, let's start off by creating our states. In this case, I'm going to go ahead and use enums to store our states. To do that, we use the enum keyword followed by the name we want to give our enum. In this case, I'm going to give it the name GameState, all capitalized, by the way, because these are considered constants. And on top of that, I'm going to create three different states, a menu state, a serve state, and a play state. From the menu state, we will then transition into the serve state. And from the serve state, we will then transition into the play state. Lastly, from the play state, we will then transition to the serve state. And so there will be a loop between the serve and play state. I'm also going to create a serve state. This is to make sure we know which direction the ball will take in a later episode. In this case, we're just going to use a simple variable called isPlayerServe and assign that the value true because we want the player to serve first. We can change this value to false when it's time for the AI to serve. However, we will not be doing that in this episode. I'm going to go ahead and change this value back to true. all we did was create enum values for our game state, so let's go ahead and actually assign that to a variable. In this case, let's go ahead and create a variable called current game state, and we will assign it a value from our enum game state. I assign the value menu because we want the player to start in the menu state. Heading over to the physics process virtual method, this is where we will actually change our code based on the state we are in. I'm going to use a match statement, however, feel free to use an if statement if you want. Regardless, we need to test the value inside the variable current game state. And in this case, because I'm using a match statement, I can just list out each individual enum. To reiterate, the current game state variable is the expression we are testing against, and each individual enum is what we are testing the variable current game state with. Now, let's actually do something with our game state. For this example, let's go ahead and change our string value that we present to the player on the screen based on our game state. On first glance, this looks pretty good. However, when we run it, it may appear that our string values are centered. However, let me go ahead and change this, add more sentences onto our string, and if we run our game, you can see that our string is not actually centered. It only gave the illusion that it was centered based on how small the text was. This problem actually stems in the ready virtual method. As you can see here, we are calculating our width of our font and the string position before we actually change the string value. The solution is quite simple. All we have to do is take that logic outside the ready virtual method and apply it after we have changed the string value inside of our match statement. Now, when we run our code, we can see that our string is now centered when the game changes states. In this case, we are not really changing states, so let's go ahead and add some player input listeners and change states when, for example, the player presses the space bar. To do this, all we have to do is use an if statement and using the global class input followed by the isKeyPressed method, it takes in a scan code, which is just an integer value. Lucky for us, Godot does provide global enums for scan codes. In this case, we want to test whether or not the player has pressed the spacebar. When the spacebar has been pressed, we will need to change the current game state variable. So in this case, since we are inside the menu game state, when the spacebar has been pressed, we will change it to the serve state. In this case, let's go ahead and copy everything because the code will be the same no matter what state we are in since we are just changing string values. Also, one thing to note is that we need to call the draw method every time we want to update values inside our draw methods. In this case, I use the update method in order to call everything inside the draw method. Now, as you can see here, every time we press the space bar, we change game state. However, if I were to hold down the space bar button, notice what's happening here. It just spams out. So let's go ahead and fix that. At the top of our file, let's go ahead and create a variable that we can compound our delta time in order to make sure that there is a delay when changing game state. In this case, we're going to create a variable called delta key press and assign it a float value of 0. At the top of our physics process virtual method, we'll go ahead and compound the delta value onto our variable called delta key press. Make sure to remove the underscore in the delta variable, as we will now be using the delta argument provided to us by the physics process virtual method to compound the time value onto our variable called delta key press. From there, we will make sure to add an extra logic check inside of our if statements. So in this case, if our player has pressed the spacebar and if more than 0.3 seconds have elapsed since the last spacebar key press, go ahead and change the game state. And we will add this logic into every if statement. We do have to do one more thing, and that is every time our player has pressed the space bar, we need to reset our delta key press value back to the float value of 0. Now, if I were to run this game, you can see that if I hold the space bar, there is a little delay between changing our state based on key presses from the player. Now, there is a little bit of a problem here. As you can see, I hard-coded literal float values into our game logic. Hard-coding literal values is considered magic numbers. And what that means is that we don't understand what exactly our numbers are referring to. We don't understand what the purpose of 0.0 is and what the purpose of 0.3 is. To fix this, all we have to do is extract these literal values and assign them to variables or constant variables. So let's go ahead and do that. In this case, I'm going to head back to the top of the file and create two additional constant variables to hold our never-changing values. The first constant will be called reset delta key, and it will hold the float value of 0. The second constant variable will be called max key time, and it will hold our total delay time, which will be 0.3. I then go ahead and assign the value of reset delta key onto our variable called delta key press. Removing our magic numbers is as easy as replacing our literal values with our constant variables. Having our code structured this way gives us an additional benefit of testing out new values. In this case, I set the delay to 2 seconds, and as you can see here, holding down the spacebar has quite a delay. After testing that 2 seconds is too long, I'm going to go ahead and change that value back to 0.3. And as you can see here, the benefit of using variables, or in this case, constant variables, over magic numbers is that we have a single point of truth, a single place where we can edit code and see the changes propagate throughout our entire code base. Now, I want you to notice something here. We are basically duplicating the highlighted code in multiple places. We don't necessarily have to do this. And so what I'm going to do is a technique called function extraction. In function extraction, we go ahead and we take out certain lines of code if they follow or fulfill a specific goal. In this case, the goal of the highlighted code was to change the string value that was displayed for the player. So let's go ahead and create a function called changeString with one parameter that takes in a value, which we will name newStringValue. What we do is we take our variable called stringValue and replace it with the newStringValue passed inside our parameter. On top of that, we need to calculate the width of the font and the string position for centering our text on the screen. So I'm going to go ahead, copy paste that into our changeString function. Lastly, we need to call the update method. This is so we force a call to the drawVirtual method so we can see the string changes appear on our game screen. Lastly, all we need to do is delete those duplicated code lines and replace it with our new function. And inside the function, we pass in the string value we wish to show on the game screen when the game state changes. When we run the game, when we press the spacebar, you can see that the changes are in fact propagating to the game screen. Let us recap the refactoring techniques done in this episode. A magic number is a literal float or integer in code that provides no context. Magic numbers provide context only to those that have worked on the code and is hard for new people to the project to grasp the usefulness of the hard-coded values. To fix the issues that magic numbers provide is to extract them into a constant variable. Next is the function extraction refactoring technique. A function extraction is just taking pieces of code and adding it into its own self-described function. Here we have a function called changeHealth, and we print some statistics out onto the console. And instead of leaving that inside the function called changeHealth, we remove it and create a new function called displayStats that we now can not only use inside of our function called changeHealth, but we can use it inside of other functions and places inside our code as well. If we can extract a function, then we can also insert a function. And so in this case, we have a technique called function insertion or inline function. Function insertion is taking code out of a function and adding it inside where it is needed. In this case, we have a function called displayNewHealth, and all it does is print to the screen our new health. And in most cases, this would be fine. However, in our example, we only need this in one place. In this case, it is better to insert our one line of code where it is needed rather than having it inside of its very own function. That's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for clicking the like button, and thank you for clicking the subscribe button. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.